Welcome to Sold with Webinars, a podcast that aims to uncover how the most successful experts, coaches, consultants, and e-course professionals sell their products and services with just one sales presentation or webinar. A simple sales webinar can transform the business and life of a solopreneur. And this podcast will show you how other experts just like you are generating six and seven figures per year online with their webinars. So let's get started. Hey, everybody, Joel Irway here, and welcome to another episode of Sold with Webinars. Holy cow, you guys are going to love this episode. I just got off my pre-podcast interview with our guest today, Dan Kuschell, and in just a second, I'm going to give you his brief bio, but I'm super excited because what we're going to be learning today is something I've never even heard of before until about 3 minutes ago. And so I'm going to be going into this interview with tons of questions, as I'm sure you, the listener, are going to have. And so I'm going to do my best not to get all giddy and and super excited like a fanboy, but we are going to be learning about something called the interview style webinar. And for anyone who hasn't had a whole lot of experience in the webinar space and the digital marketing space, I would say, I mean, I've only got about 4 years of experience in the digital marketing space, and I've never heard of this. I've just heard of the traditional style sales webinars. And so Dan, who is a seasoned veteran in direct response marketing, seasoned veteran in this industry and has helped tons and tons of business owners, coaches, entrepreneurs, you name it, he's got a ton of experience. So Dan, welcome to the show.
Joel, it's a pleasure to be with you again, my friend. How are you?
Yes, I'm fantastic, man. Let me give a short bio for everyone who's listening right now before we hop into our interview so we can prep them, so we can let them know who they are listening to and why they should be super excited. So Dan is a husband, a dad, an angel investor, and advisor, and helps business owners and entrepreneurs have a bigger impact, reach, and contribution. He's built more than 11 companies since 1992. He's coached over 5,329 business owners and entrepreneurs on growing their business. And after selling two of his companies following a health scare, Dan spends his time working with fun projects as an advisor and strategic growth partner, leveraging his champion business technologies, and has had clients like Joe Polish, Genius Network, and a heck of a lot more. Dan, that's a heck of a resume. That's a heck of an introduction. And I know it only tells a small sliver of your full story. I'm excited to get into our interview today. I'm excited to have you share the knowledge of this thing that you call the interview style webinar.
I'm looking forward to it, Joel. Let's rock.
All right. So I want to jump right in into where we left off our pre-interview conversation. Now, you had told me that you had been doing these teleseminars, these webinar style, one-to-many sales presentations in a different form since 1994. So here we are in 2017. I mean, what is that, 23 years or something like that? I don't know.
In internet years, that's like 240 years.
Yeah, that's a long time. It's a long time. So I want to learn, just like my audience wants to learn, take me back to 1994 when you were first introduced and set the stage, right? Before we get into the interview style, like set the stage for where this all came about and give us some prep work as to what led to us getting into this situation in 1994.
Yeah, it even starts before then. You know, short version, Joel, is I have been fascinated with direct response marketing since I can remember. My dad took me to my first, you can call it seminar, or it was a clinic actually, and it was actually for sports. When I was 10. So that would have been in 1979. And I remember a page in this clinic I attended, and it talked about attitude, right? A PMA, you know, that in baseball, because it was a baseball clinic, in baseball, sports, and life, success is 90% mental and the rest physical. Mm-hmm. And I still remember that today. And so then fast forward, my dad introduced me to some other things. And my sister, when I was finishing up high school, going into college, she got me a job in a direct response, a direct mail company that worked specifically with health clubs doing consulting. And I got so fascinated by the idea that you could take a message, put it on a piece of paper, or put it on the radio, or put it on TV, and then put an 800 number in it. And then people would actually call, respond, and not just respond and say, hey, how are you? What's up? They would actually then give you money. And like, so I became like, you know, obsessed in many ways. I mean, and most people who know me know I'm fairly obsessive compulsive anyway. And I got obsessed with learning the psychology. And then now today, when you combine psychology and technology, I mean, you can get incredible leverage, incredible breakthroughs, et cetera, when you take the time to learn how to master it. And so, you know, one of the, you know, platforms that I was introduced, you know, in the 90s, actually it was the late 80s, was this idea that you could speak to one to many, right? It's a huge leverage, you know, methodology. You know, put yourself in a position to speak to large groups of people at one time. And the second part of that is do the work one time and get paid over and over, right? Mm-hmm. You know, imagine what would happen for all of our business if we really spent the time to focus on those two simple ideals. Well, I got introduced to a way to do that back then, which was teleseminars, right? And so, you know, I started learning from people who were having success enrolling people through that methodology and studied what they did, what they didn't do, you know, getting the scripting, et cetera. And, you know, now fast forward to today, you know, someone like you, I mean, you're one of the, if not the best in the world at showing people how to do what it is that you do using a platform like a webinar. And what I love about what you teach, Joel, which, you know, I think resonates even in what I do, is I look at you, yes, you're a tactician, and that's important, but more importantly, you're a scientist from a strategy point of view. And you really, as I've gone through some of your parts of your course, you really look at the science and the psychology. So it's my belief that, let's say theoretically, that a webinar is obsolete in 5 years, theoretically, mm-hmm. right? Just like teleseminars had its day, right? Yeah. But the psychology of messaging and compelling versus repelling, pulling people in, and then also setting the stage, I've deconstructed now, use this method with this interview style, not just for me, and I've been fortunate, it's been 7 figures to my businesses over the years, for sure. But I've also analyzed people like Dean Graziosi, who's been on TV for, you know, a couple decades, mm-hmm. and the psychology applies. I've looked at your scripting and what you teach. That psychology applies. So let's say there's some new platform that comes out in 3 years. I have no doubt that, like, using your formula of psychology with technology, it'll still work. And that's mm-hmm. what we have today. And, you know, I'd love to share some of those insights with you and your community.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. You nailed it right on the head. And the more that I jump into the sales world, not necessarily the marketing world, but like the sales world and how to control, I have to be very careful the way that I use the word control, but how we guide the sales conversations, and the structure is all the same. Now with webinars, we do a lot of teaching in the middle, which is great, but I was listening to some sales training by Kevin Nations last night, and it was the same process. It's like setting the intention and then figuring out why they're here. And it's literally the same components, just reframed and restructured in a different presentation or a different medium. And so I'm very fascinated to learn what this interview style script is. And so you said before 1994, you brought us up to speed. So set the stage for the first time that you did one of these. Like, what was the situation? How did you come up with, you know, the idea to do a teleseminar, an interview style teleseminar, and how did it go?
Well, you know, frankly, if I remember back, you know, this is a long time, so I have to say I don't remember all of
the details.
We won't
do any records
checks. I'll think of the feeling. Like what I do remember is I was kind of forced into doing my first one, frankly, right? Because, you know, we were in a direct sales organization, and, you know, one of the people, the coaches or mentors that I was working with, he's like, okay, it's your time, go do it. You know, and so that forced me into doing the first one. And because of my background, which I'm more of an introvert, I'm more reserved in many ways. And it was very uncomfortable. It was clunky. I'm sure I skunked most. I don't remember what had happened. I think I actually did get an enrollment or two from that first one, whereas others were getting dozens, mm-hmm. if not more, when they would do it. But it was clunky, it was uncomfortable, it was probably messy, as truth be told, what that first one was. Yeah.
Cool. Okay. So what is it? What does this script look like? I mean, my audience are probably familiar with the standard, okay, we're gonna teach and then we're gonna make an offer, but, you know, doesn't seem like there's any teaching here, right? Or like no structured content. Maybe I'm wrong. I'm just going off of an assumption. When I hear interview webinar, I'm thinking just conversation. I mean, in a very strategic way, but I'm thinking a conversation. Like, what is it?
Yeah. So let me give you an example. And so, you know, fast forward to me doing a bunch of these on my own and, you know, messing it up a lot, right? You know, what's that old saying, fail our way to success, mm-hmm. if you will. I think people sometimes ask, you know, Joel, you know, Dan, like, what's one of your superpowers? It's the ability to get through mistakes, right? Yep. And you just repeat them and make it happen. you know, the first time I did this with a joint venture strategic partner was in 2005, right? Most of the time I had been doing it, and I had this crazy, well, what if I actually shared this with someone else and teamed up with them? And I'll be the host. I'll ask the questions because I know the script. And then they could just do what they do and know their content and do it in this way. And I didn't even have to explain it to them. I would just, what you said, be the guide to them, right? Mm-hmm. And so I did this with a guy named Telman, who, you know, is pretty well known in different circles. And Telman and I did this, and this is 2005, again, free this. And it was a high ticket program for like $2,495. And we generated over six figures in sales in one night, right? For, you know, it was about a 60 to 70 minute teleseminar call, right? And I'll get into the dynamics of that. And then, you know, we had another client I worked with named Joshua. He had a program called the NPOD system. And we did this with Joshua, same kind of thing. We just guided him through the process. And we not only did it once, but it worked so well the first time, we did it a few more times and generated a couple hundred thousand from it, right? But the psychology, and so the place I want to start is actually the, I guess, the psychology of selling, right? Mm-hmm. You talked about, you know, you're studying Kevin. And one of the things that we hear sometimes, you know, as you're watching or listening, you ever, you know, like thought to yourself, oh God, you know, sales, I don't want to be like, I don't want to be like a salesman, or marketing is bad, or marketing is evil, or whatever, right? So I want to kind of, you know, debunk that belief for a second, right? I love Dan Sullivan's definition of selling, which is just awesome. It's getting someone intellectually engaged in a future result that's good for them. Mm-hmm. So they emotionally commit to take action to achieve that result, right? So, you know, we've all heard probably that people buy emotionally and they justify logically. So what I love about Dan's is, number one, it combines those two things, getting someone intellectually engaged in a future result that's good for them so they can emotionally commit to take action to achieve that result. The other part of that framework that I love is that's good for them, right? I see selling as simply being able to help somebody. Right. I've heard many experts like Joe Polish, who have done a lot of work with, say that all selling is influence. Right. Marketing is storytelling. Right. So getting that out of the way. Right. Now we get into like, well, how does it work? So I am looking at the script that I did with Telman in 2005 right here, right now. And again, as I cross analyzed this between yours, your webinar model, and this, and yours is far more detailed. And I highly recommend, if you're not familiar with Joel's work, just go get access to it straight up. I like to take pride in this because I guess this is prehistoric.
Yeah.
right. So here it is, the outline, the promise of our call, right? So it's the big promise. And so we go into show you how to X, you know, so your big benefit with or without your, and then X, Y, and Z for people who want to X, Y, and Z, right? So welcome. We would like to introduce you to the name of the expert and then name the big promise. And oh, by the way, make sure to stick around to the very end because we have some gifts for you. And then you state the value of those gifts. So make sure to stick around to the very end of our training today, right? Mm-hmm. So this is starting it off. Then now that we've laid the big promise, we've, you know, put a hook to stick around to the very end. Now we actually go into a very short condensed bio of that person. Because let's face it, why are people, you know, why are people listening to this podcast, right? It's not for us. It's like, what's in it for them? Mm-hmm. You know, you want to walk away with, you know, essentially the big promise is the interview script webinar model. You know, in my case, it's generated seven figures. I've deconstructed Dean Grazia. He's been on TV using this kind of interview type style script, and it's generated, I don't know exactly, but tens of millions of dollars for him. So what could it do for you, right? That's what you care about as you're listening or watching right now. So question number one, and then I'm going to pause for a second because maybe you've got some jumping off questions. So your name of the person, right? What steps can someone take to create a, and then the big promise, right? And then that's just where you, and I've got bullets for him that we gave him. Give a checklist of simple 3 to 7 points that they can, you know, write down right now. So they get some immediate value while you also integrate your background a little bit. And also build in me toos, right, as you think of it. So good ways to do that, Joel, and you teach this and you're a master at it, which is, you know, things like imagine if you, and you're speaking to one individual, you know, what if you could, and then you go into it, right? So for example, what if you could take this, you know, interview script generator, put it in place in your business, and maybe because, you know, doing one-to-many webinars is one way to work it, but maybe you'd like to create some chemistry with someone who could interview you using this template, and it would make it come across more like an expert interviewing you. Mm-hmm. And it creates an extra layer of endorsement. And I learned this in radio too, having, you know, been on NBC and having my own show on NBC for many years, interviewing over 350 of the best experts. A lot of that came from this too. So anyway, that's the first parts of the foundation of the interview style webinar script.
So let's say that the two of us are doing an interview style webinar, right? Let's imagine this. You're going to be the expert and I'm going to be the one interviewing you, right? So fast forwarding to the end of the interview, whatever the product is that we're selling, are we selling what you're teaching, or like in terms of congruency with the expert versus the program, are we going to sell what you're an expert in, like whatever your program is? Or what is the core thing that we're selling?
Yeah, so a great way, and I wish I had a slide to show this. So you have one person who's the host interviewing the expert, mm-hmm. right? And yep. that host facilitates the questions
yep.
and preps the movement and the momentum that leads to ultimately making a decision or the sale or mm-hmm. the enrollment in that sale, right? Now, the way this is set up, the host will actually facilitate the close. But it's up to the guest expert, if you will, who you know is selling their particular product, to really get into the close, to you know really feed on. Now, as a good host, you can then add extra endorsements and make mm-hmm. it real, you know, almost like an implied, you know, constant endorsement or set of testimony. You know, we all know that testimonials are critical in our business model. Well, when you have this host experience, so think of it this way, you know, if you're a guest on Oprah Winfrey's show, you don't need 42 testimonials in your message.
Right.
You've got Oprah.
Yep.
And she's the power of 42. You go on Howard Stern's show, right? You don't need 42 people in addition to Howard Stern. You've got an implied endorsement from Howard Stern, a lot of power there. So in an environment like this, what I have found and discovered, Joel, and why it can work counterintuitively and exponentially compared to a one-to-one model mm-hmm. is this implied endorsement that goes on. And it's a paradigm that I learned back in the early 90s, which is this idea, you know, how many of us have ever heard that, you know, to get people to buy from us, they must what? Like us and trust us.
No like and trust. Yep.
No like and trust. Now, I believe that to be a half truth. I believe that if you just follow the letter of that law, you'll actually be misled. And many times you'll still struggle with your sales. Now, I believe a strong part of it, but I think something's left out, at least from my experience. And that's one other thing, which is respect. Mm-hmm. See, people buy from, I've bought from people that I didn't completely know yet or completely like yet, but I did trust them to some degree. But there was the one other piece, which is respect. And see, this model, the radio model, the Howard Stern model, the Oprah model, is built on what I'm describing, which is trust and respect. Mm-hmm. So what happens is between a host like you, in this case with me, you're the host, and between you and your audience, you have trust, mm-hmm. right?
Yep.
So if you come and endorse me as like the NASA scientist, and I'm a doctor, I play a doctor on TV, and I've stayed at a Holiday Inn Express, well, there's a respect factor your audience is just going to have with me, mm-hmm. right? Or any guest that you would interview. So it takes the trust and the respect. And when you can lift both of those in an environment, it accelerates sales, mm-hmm. right? So that's a way to really look at it. But it is truly up to the host to facilitate, and really they're guiding the process, but the expert really has to drive the message and then also the enrollment too.
Perfect. Okay. So then kind of going through the process of that, that's a giant cup, by the way. That's a huge red solo cup.
I got my iced tea in here. objects may appear bigger than they really are. It's actually not as big as you might think. Yeah. I just have a little head. My wife says I have a little head that's not really as big as it looks.
Okay. So, all right. So I want to get into the flow now of the interview style webinar, because the typical webinars that I facilitate and that I teach, there's a lot of content that, you know, it's the expert. There's only one person. That's the expert who's leading it, teaching it, and making the offer. So how much teaching is really being done inside? Because if I think now about a talk show, whether it's Ellen, whether it's Oprah, whether it's, well, I don't know if Dr. Oz is really considered a talk show, but like, we'll just say Ellen or Oprah, right? I don't really know how much teaching they're actually doing and educating. I mean, like they are, but in a webinar style, sometimes we get into, I don't ever like to go into super details, but we do have to teach. So what's the difference? Like how does it look in terms of your format?
Well, my format does have teaching involved.
Okay.
Now,
okay.
There are other experts, by the way, Joel, and you know probably some of the ones I would refer to. You pair us side by side, and they'll outsell me all day long, right? There are better enrollers, better closers. I look today for sustainability, reputation. I don't want to be like a douchey closer, if you will.
It's a huge part that I've talked about recently.
And that's what I love about your model is it's just genuine. There's high value to it. Whether someone buys from you or not, they leave feeling, wow, this is awesome, right? And most of the time, it's just they're not a right fit today. It's not a right fit ever. It's just today. Whereas there are some people, as you know, like whether it's you know speaking in front of the stage or doing a webinar or even doing phone type of enrollments or teleseminars, they're just like really, they make you and me and everybody kind of feel uncomfortable around them. And that's just not my style. So, So this does have a lot of value built into it right now, based on time, then that's the factor. And we speak to that elephant in the room. And that's, by the way, and I know you share this as well, is use that languaging in your webinars or in your teleseminars or in your communicate or any of your sales messaging. Think of like, what is the thing that they're probably skeptical about? What is the thing that they're, that they're most hesitant about? And just call it out and go, let me just go ahead and stop for a second. Let me speak to the elephant in the room. Mm-hmm. We only have about 40 minutes for this conversation, right? So there's only so much that we can go through. We certainly can go much deeper, and maybe we'll make this available to you that you can modify it for your business too and make it available through Joel, right? But in this, in part, let me go to it. In part 6 of our process. So the first 5 steps are really about the framing and setting the stage. And I'll come back to those. But in part 6, the way we set up this, and again, this is for, there's a purpose for it. So there's interviews just to do interviews and get out value. And then this is interviews specifically to make sales of higher end type of programs or products or services, right?
Yep.
So step 6 here, the way we set it up, it's, and I'll just read it. Most of the questions we have come in fit under one of a few main categories. And then what you do is you identify 3 main categories that you have your biggest questions. Then you go in and say, regardless of the question, I think if we covered these things, we'd have an incredible win for our interview and our training today, wouldn't we? Well, great. Let's get started. And now you just cover part 1. Where can I? And then you name the first one. How can I? The second one. How do I, the third one, right? And so now that's the expert's opportunity to really get into some teaching. And again, the host is ideally, if they're seasoned a little bit, they can help facilitate some good questions, jumping off points, extra insights or distinctions that also add value to a sales process as well. So there's science behind this. Anyway, I don't know. Does that help?
Yeah, it makes total sense. And it's so much more fluid because the way that we do our webinars, and when you say, how can I do X? And then we talk about that first piece of content. How can I do Y? And you teach the second piece. How can I do, Z? And that's the third piece. When we give presentations, when it's just this, a solo host, we actually will say those and we'll put it on a slide. So we're implanting that conversation in the mind of our audience. And we'll say, okay, we just introduced you to this system, which is normally would be X for us. As we transition to Y, which would be part number 2, we will have to introduce that concept into their mind to have that two-way conversation and know that we know what they're talking about. And so I'll say something like, you're probably thinking X, Y, Z. And that's when I go into part number 2. So that makes total sense. I get it. And if anyone's going through the training, they'll understand what you're saying as well. And it makes total sense.
So, by the way, the first 5 steps that I mentioned are the foundation. It's the rapport building, right? I've discovered in any sales process that rapport is probably the number one factor in whether sales happen or they don't, right? And that's why that trust respect triangle that I shared, that framework earlier, is so critically important to think of. Trust and respect. How do I create maximum trust and maximum respect in what I do? Now, testimonials, social proof, do that, right? That's why I believe, although others use the term just social proof, I believe it's because of the elevated trust and respect that gets created from social proof and testimonials, right? Yep. So the first 5 steps, and would it be helpful if I went through those first 5 foundations?
Yeah, let's do it.
And I'll cover it, and then if you have questions, step 2, and I'll use you here, Joel, as though we were doing this. Joel, there are a lot of other webinar experts out there, or so-called, actually. There are a lot of so-called webinar experts out there. You know, what is it that really makes you unique compared to anybody else?
You want me to answer?
Well, I know the, yeah, this is your view. Go.
All right. So I would actually piggyback on kind of what you were saying is, you know, there's a difference between selling more and retaining your sales. And so when you make the sale, if it's high pressure, you're going to have a much higher refund rate or buyer's remorse on the back end. And that can really cripple your business on just a couple of different levels, whether it's your merchant account, whether it's just your internal reputation and dealing with not even angry customers, but dealing with unwanted customers. Because the people that you convince to buy, like you have to hard sell them, they're instantly going to have that buyer remorse, and they're the ones who are going to need the most handholding. So
absolutely.
So it's not necessarily how you get the most conversions. It's more how do you retain your customer value as long as possible. Increase that lifetime customer value without killing yourself in the same time. So that's the main difference.
And that's perfect, right? And, you know, and I even put a couple notes in here as well. You know, the ideas of walking our talk. How do you do that? Credibility. You know, I've been able to do X, Y, and Z. And then flipping it back. And my goal is to show you how to do the same thing I've been able to do and implement it in your business. And another key part is then a little bit of a takeaway. I'm going to do X with what I do anyway. Mm-hmm. So if you decide not to put this in place, it's going to cost you more than if you do. Mm-hmm. And I just love to introduce you to all the best strategies we've got available. So that's part two. Step three is this framework. You know, I know we're going to have a lot of questions here at the end because we're actually going to do a live Q&A when we wrap up. And we've got the special gifts that we mentioned as well. For those of you who are excited, Joel is conducting a live Q&A at the end of the training, and the gifts he's going to be giving away could be worth thousands to you. So you're going to want to stick around. In fact, and now we lead to step four. You know, Joel, I know something you teach in your programs, and you just lead by this because this is the type of person that you are, you know, is generosity and reciprocity, which is a strategy from Robert Cialdini in his book, Influence, right? Now, you recommend that people actually utilize gifts or bonuses in their business. Now, why do you recommend this? So I'll just stop.
Yeah.
Right. So that framework of generosity, contribution, gifting, bonuses,
yep,
is built into the script. And why you actually do it. And then, you know, then there's a little bit of jumping off points for the expert, if I were interviewing you for this, of why you would do that, mm-hmm, right? And it's also setting a little bit of a hook of what's coming for that particular product or service. Then step five, another one of the principles I've come to learn is that you've got to begin with the end in mind, which is a Stephen Covey quote. And I've heard you refer, and most of what I've seen you build seems to follow that principle too. What would you say to that? Now, this is where you start layering in just a couple tips, and it's more of the bigger overarching psychology and character of an individual, mm-hmm, overall. And then that leads us to the part five, which is the questions, the framework to be able to teach, which we already covered a little bit. So anyway, that's the first five of the seven steps.
That's awesome. So what I like about it, so I'm always skeptic about lots of new things. And I wouldn't say that I'm skeptic about this, but I'll raise my thoughts and I'll have you kind of knock them down and or respond to them, right? I like this because it's more natural, right? It can be, yes, more conversational, which a lot of people who go through my webinar training, I tell them to script out everything. And some of them, they have a really hard time reading from a script, and rightfully so. Completely understand, because that's an art of being able to practice your voice inflection and, you know, layering your tones and all that stuff. And so I could totally see how this would make that a little bit more easier for those types of people to have that conversation without reading from a script. Where I become just a little bit hesitant is, like, I could see this work for like a JV partnership where, you know, you're doing this to somebody else's audience, or I'm doing it to your audience, you're doing it to my audience. But those presentations always crush because there's that layer of trust and respect that's already built in. Now, does this work with cold traffic too? And what are your thoughts on that? That's always the big question. How does this work for cold traffic?
Well, I've seen it work for cold traffic. And at the end of the day, I think it comes to the talent, mm-hmm, right? The capabilities, the skill sets that we have or we don't have. overall. One of the things I love about this process, Joel, is it's a couple parts. Number one, like you said, for someone new to script out an entire process can be a little bit arduous, right? It can be a little bit intimidating. Now, you have such great tools to guide people and facilitate through that process, so it makes it so much easier. What, you know, Joel Polish refers to in Genius Network, more ELF, easy, lucrative, and fun instead of half, which is hard, annoying, lame, and frustrating, right? So you make it more ELF instead of half, right? This process, I think, also makes it more ELF, easy, lucrative, and fun instead of half, too, because this could even almost be like a precursor to kind of flesh out some of the best insights overall, right? As a version one, right? Using the architecture
and then record it.
Like this is, and this is how I did it and how I learned to get better at it. Because again, my first bunches of these, I bet you I've done 5,000, you know, versions of teleseminars or today what we call webinars and presentations, at least, probably more than that. And I would take them and then ultimately get them transcribed, or back before there were transcription services that, you know, the affordability we have today, I would literally sit there and critique it and listen to it and dissect it and then re-architect it, right? Oh. So it gives you the ability to get better at your messaging and it becomes natural or more natural. And that's a way to be able to guide people. So you interview them utilizing this style, then record it, then transcribe it, and then go, okay, well, now let's really add what would be the PowerPoint slides, right, with the wording and the scripting. Let's make sure we focus on those critical pieces because you're missing those. And now it can refine it. And then now what happens is you ultimately build in, you've got two different ways to present the same idea, right? Imagine like in your model where you're so good, because I wouldn't want to interfere with that at all. You have your people that do your webinar style. Mm-hmm. But then as follow-up, like 7 days after the initial, they do an interview with an expert that's essentially just a repackaged webinar, but in an interview style delivered in a different, unique format, right? Mm-hmm. What kind of impact would that have? You know, we can lead a horse to water, we can't make it drink. And if we're a drill bit and we put a drill in, it gets stuck, what do? You don't keep pushing it in. In other words, we don't keep running that webinar down their throat. Well, you take a different approach. And this is also a very easy other way to get that information out, right?
Oh, so, man.
So anyway, a few different ways to think about it. So can it work for cold traffic? It can. It is dependent on your capability, but it's a great teaching tool to refine. And then I just like this style personally, because like you said, it just is very genuine. It's authentic. I do love webinars, certainly. And this can also be a good one to just test and see how people engage with what you have in the first place.
Well, I mean, what you said, okay, so I'm going to relate this to writing a book, okay, right? Anyone who's tried to write a book, I mean, you look at any book publishing service, any book writing service out there, and like their primary selling point is how much work and effort it takes to actually get the book written. And I know you and I both have friends in the book writing industry, and the secret to what they do is they're just interviewing the author and they're helping them extract the ideas from their mind. And so we have an interview script that we do for our private clients when we start to onboard them. And we have a set of structured questions, but it still leaves a lot of interpretation. But I can see why your interview style helps get the rough draft out as quickly as possible, because you ask the question and then you rattle on for 5 or 10 minutes and then edit it and revise it. Like, oh man, I have gotten so many ideas just with that, the light bulb finally clicked. It's like, okay, this is why, you know, book writing services charge a lot, is because they take that painful skill. That's why we charge a lot, because it takes people a long time to write a webinar, and I can totally see how this could help shorten the process. That's awesome.
Yeah, and I mean, you know, as an example, so cold traffic, we did this, you know, I shared an example of Tellman and Joshua, so Randy Gage, I don't think I mentioned in this interview, but Randy, we were talking beforehand, so mm-hmm. Randy Gage, who's pretty well known in different circles and, you know, speaking expert and all that stuff. There was an event he was doing, and this is back in like 2005, right? And they were running an event, and apparently there was some issue, and, you know, they didn't have as many people as they wanted at the event. And so my buddy Joshua, who I'd done this for already, is like, hey, could you help us out? You know, it's about a month before the event. We could use, you know, an extra bolt of sales and people to attend to make it a better event. I was like, oh, of course. So we ran this model to his traffic. I think I had a friend of mine who said, yeah, I'll run it and help you out, help them out. you know, it sounds like it'd be a perfect fit. It's not competing with what we do. And we did this exact model I'm describing. We had Randy, his partner at the time, I think Ford, and Joshua. And I did it with three other people, which is awkward, in this type of interview style, use this, probably almost this exact type of scripting with the framing. And I seem to recall we had, it was a $5,000 event, Joel. We had 20 people attend the event, if I recall. Mm-hmm. And we had equally as many people buy the home study version at that time, right? And, you know, it was a big six-figure, as I recall, a heavy six-figure event for a one-time interview style teleseminar webinar model that, you know, almost anybody can implement. So that was, you know, primarily cold traffic.
Yeah. That's great. That's awesome. Man. So the biggest thing that I've taken away from this is the interview style. I can totally see how it works. And I need to come up with a way that helps people get that first draft out using an interview style technique to help them get their first draft done, because that's much different than she's saying, okay, I want you to think about this and now write your ideas on paper. Whereas if I presented a question to them, then they could respond and that would be their answer. Oh, I love it. I love it. That's big. That's really big. So, okay. So give me an example now of, so we've gone through the first five parts. How do you transition into six parts? Okay. How do you transition into the close with the interview style?
All right. So now we've gone through six parts and we got to the education framework, and I may have called that the education framework part five, but it's six in the model. But it's part seven. Here's the transition, essentially. Guys, this is amazing information. I know you've got to love what Joel has shared with you. And we're going to do a short commercial for you. As you heard up front, Joel is putting together an incredible program to do X for you. You know, put more money in your pocket. In addition, you're also going to get over X thousands of dollars in gifts he's going to share with you in a moment too. So you're going to want to have a pen and paper handy to write this down and have your phone ready to reserve your spot. Mm-hmm. That's the transition. So Joel, you've created a program that's main promise is to show people how to double their income, double their time off, and create and develop the XYZ program, which could be for one or many of their businesses. And I have to tell you, as I look at the curriculum of what you've put together and the value that you've created, it's amazing. I know there are other so-called mentors who are creating and working with programs like this, and it doesn't look like it compares at all of what you're offering. They're charging X dollars or more than you're offering for something far less. In fact, one of the people you do a lot of promotions for as a program where they're charging X upfront and X per month, right? And you're offering it for so much less. Can you tell us about it, right? So now, and here are a couple jumping off points. You start with the promise, and this is going to probably be counterintuitive from most sales training and scripting I've seen. The promise is, yes, I'm so confident what I teach that I'm willing to make a no-risk guarantee. It's that simple. And you add that here versus waiting later in the presentation. If someone gets started with the program, I'm going to show them how they can get, you know, X, Y, and Z. And if they don't feel they've learned how to create an extra X, if they don't think that I've given them access to the very best tools in the world for the lifetime of their business, I don't want their money. It's that simple. In fact, I'm so confident that if by the X session of the program, if they haven't felt they've learned how to increase by X, they can contact our office and we'll issue a full refund. It's that simple. Then we go into what will someone learn by being a part of the program, right? So we start with a huge, you know, guarantee to just eliminate that potential and what that really is, and then come into the benefit of the program. What will the outcome be? What will the benefits be? And then how do they get started? Yep.
Start with the guarantee. I'm writing that down.
After you frame up what it, you know, what it is, right? Yep. As you make your big promise about the program, as you, you know, explain the name of it, you know, generally what it will do, you do a little juxtapositioning on the pricing compared to others, right? That ideally they're familiar with, right? Yep. Name those. And then you, and I want to get it right out of the clear right now, is that we're so confident what our teeth, we're going to give you a no risk guarantee as, you know, to make it a no brainer. Let me tell you what that is. And then let me tell you what the, you know, program really will do for you as well. Because ideally by now they've gotten a taste of what you can do for them in the interview. I mean, with the how to, so there's been a lot of that psychology and again, trust, respect. Mm-hmm. So that we've been elevating in this process, the trust, respect throughout the interview. And ideally as they're telling stories, they're integrating some of the case studies or testimonials that they've had results with in their explanations as well. So anyway,
have you ever framed the offer in the beginning of your interview, not necessarily going over the components, but saying, we've got an offer for you at the end, or we have a special discount for you at the end? Or do you normally wait until this part seven?
So we do that in part four, right? It's, you know, the part where we say, in fact, for all of you, I know it's something you teach in your business, you know, is coming from contribution, reciprocity, or doing utilizing bonuses and gifts in your business, right? And so this is the key. Why do you do a free training like this? So this would be your response as the expert. You know, in fact, I'm often asked, why would I do a free training like this, right? Well, our motive is simple. We're going to offer you so much value for free up front that when we talk about our upcoming program, where people can ultimately work with us directly, right? And, you know, double their income in half the time, there are a large majority of you who are going to want to say, yes, I have to find a way to work with Joel. And the beauty is if someone doesn't, my other businesses are going to generate X anyway. I get to do what I love overall. We'll go through that with you a little bit more detail in the end. But first, we want to give you a glimpse or a glance at some of the strategies right here, right now. So that's in part four, which is usually within about the first 8 minutes, the 10 minutes of the interview.
Yeah, that's great. So I recently had I had another podcast interview, one of the earlier episodes. I think it might have been two or three before this one with Tim Page. Tim has done hundreds and hundreds of webinars for Lead Pages and a bunch of other software companies. He has a great story. Everyone who's listening right now, hopefully you go and you listen to it, because he was a vacuum salesperson selling a $3,000 vacuum door to door. Like 4 years ago. Like, this is very, very recent.
Wow.
And he would walk in, and if they let him in the door, he would say, listen, this is a $3,000 vacuum. I'm just going to put that out there right now. Chances are you're probably not going to want to buy it, but I want you to know upfront, this is the price, because I don't want to, you know, I don't want to do any sort of sleight of hand and knock you on your butt at the end when I go over all the features. And I want to show you that this is a $3,000 vacuum, and now let me show you why. So he flips it on its head, and he said he was the top salesperson. And it was, I mean, a $3,000 vacuum. Who's going to buy a $3,000 vacuum, especially cold, door to door? And he did.
That's amazing.
He did very, very well. And so we're implementing that into some of our webinars, where we will actually give the price, give very, very, very quick details, and say, like, listen, that's what it is. I want you guys to know. Now let me prove to you why this is worth it. And we'll give you a lot of free. I want this free training to be worth five times more than, you know, the cost of the program at the end. And so, anyway, just curious if you had done that in the interview style, but it looks like you do it. Yeah.
Yeah, we do. We like to do it early on. And again, there's different applications and contextual uses for it, right? But it's step four in this process, which is, like I said, usually in the first, you know, roughly 10 minutes of the interview. You know, so you get through a little bit of the rapport building, and it's before you really get into the steps of education, just to set the framework. Yeah.
Awesome.
Love that.
So one last question before we wrap up, because this has been a really, really great, great interview. And I know that my audience is going to love it. What about interaction? Have you ever done interaction with these, like interacting with the audience in terms of, you know, these interview style, you know, teleseminars, interview style webinars, or is it really just between the two?
In this environment, it's been between the two, and then Q&A at the end. So then the interacting comes into the end. So where does that happen? So step seven is essentially, we'll call that the close, the enrollment. I like the word enrollment. To me, it just suits me better as a natural way to look at our sales process, enrollment versus closing somebody, right?
Yep.
But you do the enrollment, you go through the offer, you go through what it's all about, what the price is, how to go ahead and get it, right? And then it says here, as we wrap up, we're going to open it up for you as another bonus, like we shared up front, a live Q&A session. I hope you're ready. We're going to open up who has a question.
Awesome.
Right? And so, you know, we would typically get a lot of interaction this way. And of course, you see this in webinars today, right? You know, and a good practice is to actually ask the questions during the webinar overall. And that'd be a good test as far as in this type of environment. And then the key is, though, whenever you do a Q&A session, especially at the end of your, you know, webinar, or even, you know, if you're doing a Q&A in a live event, is then remind them of how to get started. You know, for example, in answering, it says here is a little note for both parties. Follow up and ask, can you see how the program can help you achieve your goals faster and easier, right? I imagine we'll get to work together in our program. Great. For all of you Let me just confirm how you can get started. You can reserve your spot by calling 1-800-555-1212. And our staff will answer any questions for you to lock in your spot today. Who's got another question? Right. So every two or three questions, you're just reinforcing the call to action or maybe another nuance about, you know, that particular program, product, or service as you go. And you just keep it going. Now, where this ultimately went to, Joel, is we actually took this model, we put it on a recurring 24-hour a day, 7-day a week message, number one. Then what we did is we set it up once a week where we had a traffic methodology where we drive it to that one time every week overall that was recurring at a very special time. And what would happen is at the end of it, where this Q&A piece would kick in, I would actually jump on the back end of it where it would segue. We're going to open this up to Q&A, and I would literally time it. So I would jump on. So the first, you know, whatever, call it an hour just for simplicity, would happen. And then I would jump on in the last, you know, 30 minutes and literally answer any questions. Mm-hmm. So they would have already stayed on the entire thing before I would answer their question. And then what I would do is as a hook, of course, you probably know where I'm going with this already, is how many of you would like to have an automated technology working for you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week? Well, let me share, truth be told, let me speak to an elephant in the room. How many of you have loved this up to this point? Some of you have probably been wondering if it was live or not. Truth be told, up until this moment, it wasn't. Mm-hmm. How many of you would like to put something like this that could be autopilot for you, and then you could just interact with the people who wanted to work with you the most? And they'd go, yes, well, I'd love to show you that in our program, and here's how, right? Mm-hmm. So that gave another competitive advantage in the way we presented what we did. And I see all kinds of applications in the future for this way of looking at doing it for client experience, client retention, client acquisition, right? The interactivity this way. And, you know, not only with webinars, but also things like AI coming down the pike and so on. So I could go on about that, but yeah.
It's the ultimate leverage tool, you know, yes. It really is. And, you were leveraging it back in 1994, which is pretty amazing. The one to many part. I don't know if the automation was there at that point. Was it there or not the automation?
I started implementing the full, some of my original mentors were using the 24/7 model without the interactive Q&A, mm-hmm. you know, as I recall, probably in the late 90s, frankly. And then I really loved the idea of connecting the interaction with recurring. Mm-hmm. And I did that in the early 2000s. Yeah.
Awesome. Dan, holy cow. We talked about a ton today. I'm giddy. I promised earlier on I wasn't going to try and get giddy, but I got giddy as soon as it finally clicked in my mind that we can use this interview framework to help people get the first draft written, because that's the single biggest objection that they've got is like, oh, you know, how long is it going to take me to build this? It's like, well, last question I've gotten, actually, it's tying into this. Like, how many questions are there in this setup in the interview style? Like, ballpark, are we talking 10, 15, less?
Yeah, it's less than 15.
Okay.
Yeah, it's actually probably closer to 12 when it's all said and done. And then part of it, you know, there is a flow that you get into as the interviewer, right? That you may go a little bit deeper. You know, great psychology that you teach that I notice in your framework is, you know, you give them, what is it? What does it do for you? What will it give you? What will it mean for you? Mm-hmm. So a good interviewer like you, or, you know, even if you're hearing this for the very first time and you just want to have a good framework to think about constructing offers and constructing calls to action or outcomes with people, think of it, what will that give them? Or what is it? What will it give them? So you go a little bit deeper. What will it do for them? And what will that mean for them? Mm-hmm. And ultimately, you want to try to connect whatever outcomes you get to an emotional benefit. You know, and you think of emotional benefits. And Joel, you're a student of this, so I'm probably repeating a lot of stuff that you've already taught them. But things like Tony Robbins' 6 emotional needs, which are certainty, uncertainty, love, connection, significance, growth, and contribution. Right. Mm-hmm. You know, Brendan Burchard has his own version of a emotional need chart and a Maslow's hierarchy. But if you can connect whatever it is you do ultimately with what it will do for them or what it will give them or what it will mean for them to an emotional tie of, you know, things like certainty and thriving, confidence and thriving, survive, you know, at the end of the day, our brain is wired to focus on survival instincts. And now 100%. We're in a first world country. So you still want to speak to the survival instinct but then on top of that, it's being able to thrive, which is where a lot of the other emotional connections come in.
Absolutely. I love it. Love it, Dan. We talked about a ton, man. This seven-step interview webinar, do you want to call it the interview webinar framework, or how do you coin it?
Well, I haven't coined it because literally I was doing my prep work before our thing and I was reviewing some of my old stuff. So I'm thinking of it in terms of the interview. I don't know. I haven't decided yet. But if you'd like to get it, we're going to have to come up with a way for people to actually get this thing.
Absolutely. Yeah, we can include a call to action, you know, on the show notes down below. Dan, why don't we end here with where can they find you? Tell us a little bit more about where can they connect with you and follow your podcast, follow your radio shows, everything you got. Where can they find the great Dan Kuschell?
Yeah, so, you know, if you want to reach out to us, we have some educational resources available. If you're looking for a way to connect the dots or, you know, see some of your blind spots as a small business owner or get unstuck, because I have found, and we didn't have time to go into it, Joel, right? But, you know, I have found, you know, being an entrepreneur, building and growing 11 companies, there's, you know, some things that we deal with, like burnout, overwhelm, complexity. And I had a, you know, pretty big health scare roughly two weeks after my son was born, where I ended up in a hospital and a heart procedure. And it really got me to shift some things. So my philosophy in psychology today, the champion business technology, is really about converging technology and psychology together to show business owners how to eliminate or reduce complexity, overwhelm, and burnout by incorporating these types of strategies, tools, and resources so that you can build, grow, and scale not just a successful business. Most people, most offers, most companies, most masterminds, most networking, most places are focusing on how do you grow and scale to the next level. And that's great. And that's a great place to start. I'm asking a very different question today, which is how do you build, grow, and scale a healthy business? Mm-hmm. Because the two are very different. So if you'd like to go deeper with some of the resources to be able to grow, scale, and build a healthy business so you can have a bigger reach, a bigger impact, a greater contribution, then go check out some of our resources at championbusinessblueprint.com. That's championbusinessblueprint.com. We've got a series of different, you know, webinars, in fact, that we offer, that we rotate. Of some of the latest ideas and insights that we have going at that time. But everything from hiring to marketing to business growth, you can find it there at Champion Business Blueprint. You can also check out our podcast. We've got over 100 hours of interviews of some of the top experts in the world from all kinds of crazy industries at growthtofreedom.com. That's growthtofreedom.com.
Yeah, and I'm on the interview list in August of 2018. So I will be on in about a year. Awesome. So what was that last URL? Growth to Freedom?
Yep.
Growthtofreedom.com. Okay, awesome. So the two URLs that we want to send our audience to, championbusinessblueprint.com and growthtofreedom.com. Please go reach out to Dan in any method that you can connect with him. Just let him know that you listened to this episode. You got a ton of value. He is going to be coining his interview webinar framework eventually, and he'll be using it to grow his audience. And it's phenomenal. I mean, it is really... I get so excited about it because I know how difficult it is for some people to create these sales presentations, to create these sales mechanisms. And if somebody is literally asking you questions to pull it out of you and guide it, it will expedite the process in no time. And so,
we've got to lead by example, right? So. Yep. I mean, literally, people are probably thinking, you didn't really not have a call that I didn't. I don't have a name for this because literally before this interview that we did today, I was just going through some of my old documents. This is that 2005 strategic partnership with Telman that I did. So what I'm going to do is, if you're excited to get your hands on this blueprint, this checklist, if you will, I'm going to revise it up just a little bit. But it's the blueprint we've essentially walked through today to help you clarify your message, get certainty of being able to connect with your audience, whether you're the person interviewing somebody and you want to sell more, or whether you're someone who wants to be interviewed to sell more, or utilize it with Joel's program. There's going to be a call to action button down by the time you've seen this that will be there that you can get your hand on this blueprint, which has meant at least seven figures to me. And like I said, more importantly, there's experts like guys like Dean Graziosi, that there's a lot of this psychology that was backed out. And I recognize this today in there. I even see that in Joel's program as well. Most of the things, if not all the things, are layered in here one way or another. So that'll be right down below the site right here, right now. And if you're listening, Well, just go to the site and Joel can fill you in on where that is here in just a second. And you'll see the link to get your hands on this checklist.
Yeah, you can go to soldwithwebinars.com/live and you can find the links down there. So, all right, Dan, I had a blast. My audience, they're going to love this interview. You've delivered a ton of value. I just want to thank you for your time. Thank you for sharing your expertise. I always love connecting with you. I feel like we've got great rapport and I always love picking your brain on what you know and your experience in the direct response industry and just everything regarding business. So thank you very much from all of us over here. And that's going to do it for today's episode. It went rather long, but that's great. There's a lot of great content to learn from. So until next time, thank you for listening and we'll see you on the next episode of Sold with Webinars. Take care.
Thanks so much for listening. We hope you enjoyed today's episode and we look forward to giving you the next one. You can also follow and watch the behind-the-scenes look at how I'm personally launching a brand new 6- and 7-figure product from scratch at soldwithwebinars.com/TV. And if you'd like to come hang out with other fellow experts, join our Facebook group at soldwithwebinars.com/experts. Join us next time, and I'll see you there.